Text this morning is just one verse, and again I hope it's a familiar verse, Romans 3 and 23. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. That's the bad news, which makes the good news really good news. And this morning, by God's grace, we're going to consider that together. I was listening this week to a man I listen to quite regularly, a man called David Robertson. He's the present moderator of the Free Church of Scotland. But he has what he calls a ministry called Solace, and he's involved in apologetics, if you understand what that means. It's defending the faith against those who would destroy it or debate it. And he was in a debate on the radio. And the debate, as usual, goes to the point of why does this good God allow all these bad things to happen? And David's answer has stuck with me. It's an answer which is quite helpful, and it reflects on this verse. David pointed out that people make the mistake of dividing the world into good people and bad people. His answer was this: there are no good people. There are bad people with good bits, and good people with bad bits. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Catch that again. There are no good people. There are bad people with good bits, and good people with bad bits. We're all messed up. And that came about because of the fall and sin introduced into the world. Gladly, God our Father did not leave us there, but sent his Son to deliver us from the righteous judgment that humanity deserves, so that we might indeed have a gospel to rejoice in. I want to go through this little verse under three subheadings this morning. Everyone is a sinner. Sin, then, I want to explain it, and then to show you how sin is finally excluded. That word excluded is not ideal. I couldn't come up with a better one, but you know what I mean. How it's dealt with and removed from our life. First of all, I want to come to you with something which is universally understood by Christians, that everyone is a sinner. Now, as you sit here and think about that, I'm sure you might want some debate or discussion on parts of it, but you won't accept the general premise. But it's not something that the modern world accepts. You see, since the advent of the theory of evolution, they have this concept that people are actually in a process of getting better and better and better. So modern philosophy and education and society has this naive thinking that there are good people in the world and there's going to be even better people in the future. Well, you've only to look around your world and to find out that there are some horrendously terrible things going on. And it's not just that they're done by bad people. Those bad people have good bits. They'll be kind to their wives and their children or their husband. They'll help when they see somebody needing to be lifted up. There are good bits in the bad people. And then when you look at those who claim to be good people, well, isn't it true that even when you look in the mirror, you're faced with disappointment? You're not who you know you should be. You're not who you know and think you could be. The biblical explanation for the mess that the world is in, for the mess that humanity is embroiled in, is that sin is universal. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. It's universal. It has messed up humanity. It has messed up the world itself, as I'll seek to show you. And the Bible speaks like this not so that it would grind us into the dust and tell us what miserable, horrendous, despicable people we are. The Bible tells us this so that you and I might recognize we were designed for something better. And that through Jesus Christ, that gospel comes about a God who so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. About a God who demonstrated his own love towards us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Let it sink in. I'm not proud to be a sinner, but I'm also not willing to pretend I'm not. text before us leaves no room for that, for negotiation. It confines the whole world under sin. This is God's diagnosis on mankind. It's like going to the doctor and you say, "Doctor, I've got this, that, and the next thing," and then they, from the width of depth of their knowledge, they pull out some strange disease, and that's what you've got. That's a diagnosis. But the doctor doesn't just leave you with a diagnosis, do they? They don't just tell you, "Dear friend, that's it." Generally speaking, they will also bring to you the treatment. The gospel is the treatment, if I can carry on with that analogy for some few minutes. This problem of sin then is set out clearly in the Bible. Right at the very beginning of time, it says in Genesis 3:9, "Then the Lord God called Adam and said to him, 'Where are you?' So he said, 'I heard your voice in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, and I hid myself.' And he said, 'Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree of which I commanded you that you should not eat?'" The answer should have been yes. But listen to what Adam says. "Then the man said, 'The woman whom you gave to be with me, she gave me of the tree and I ate.'" And that, what, dear friend, is an awesome picture of the effect of sin. If you remember, when God created, he underlines his creation by telling you that it was very good. Everything was functioning as designed. Until Adam and his bride Eve decided that they would take control of their own lives, their own world, and they would run things their way. They did have help from Satan, who was suggesting to them that you really couldn't trust what God was saying, and therefore you had to make your own mind up. And as soon as it's happened, you find them hiding from God. You find them unwilling to admit they're sinners and ready to blame somebody else for the trouble. Dear friend, that's a picture of how sin comes into the world. All have sinned. Every single person sins. It's ingrained in us from birth. Listen to Romans 5:12. "Just as through one man sin entered the world, and death through sin, and thus death spread to all men because all sinned." You see, even in a young child, I'm fascinated quite often to watch infants at work when they're obviously growing up and they're having to learn to function in their own world. But it always seems to go beyond all that they need, because they throw tantrums, don't they, when they can't get their own way. They choose to disobey you. We've all seen a toddler look at you with a smile as it does what you just told it not what to do. Told it not what. That didn't come out right. But you know what I mean. We see that principle in there, and we can chuckle at it while we're 2 or 3 or less. But as they grow up, there is this continuous tension, is there not, between what they should do and what they want to do, because in their little hearts there's a rebel. That's why the Bible tells us to train up a child while it's young. But as they come into mature adulthood, you find then they're making choices all the time of whether in fact they will fit in with what God has said or go their own way. The Bible is very clear in the message of God to Cain, wasn't it? Genesis 4, "Sin lies at the door and its desire is for you, but you should rule over it." You see, it's there. It's part of humanity. Since Adam and Eve fell and we then being descended from them have a fallen nature. But it's there and it's going to be challenging us all the days of our life. Even in our own personal beings, not simply in the external things we do. Psalm 4, "Be angry and do not sin. Meditate within your heart on your bed and be still." There's a principle at work in us which is indeed opposed to our Creator. It's a principle which will drag us right down and unless God deals with it, will send us to eternal hell. It's not how public your sin is. It's not whether you've been one of the guards in Belsen or somewhere. It's whether, in fact, you're ready to admit that in you there's a rebel. And that rebel wants to push God aside and run life for themselves. One of my books says, sin is that which is in opposition to God's benevolent purposes for his creation. God created the world good, put man in it, designed a garden for him to live in, gave him authority over all things, and what does man do? He says, that's not enough, I want your throne. I want to be the one who makes the final decision. And of course the psalmist says, the fool has said in his heart, no God for me. That's the battleground of sin. And the Bible is full of accounts of it. We could spend weeks just going through all the sins of people in the Bible, couldn't we? That's one of the functions of the Old Testament. It's there to show you the depravity of the human heart. Think about it for a minute. At least twice Abraham said his wife was his sister. There's a name for that, isn't there? It's called lying. Isaac imitated his father's lie. And while Abraham told a half-truth, Isaac's lie was just a blatant lie. His children were no better. Jacob cheated his brother. Moses lost his temper. Aaron, the great high priest of God, made a golden idol. King David, of whom the Bible has great accounts as being a godly man, committed or had murder done in his name and committed adultery. On you go through the Old Testament. What's one of the themes? One of the themes is that the human race is broken. And wherever you get human beings together, that brokenness will come out. And it's not simply that we're broken in relationship to each other. It's not simply that we don't always fit in with each other. We want our own way. The fact is that that horizontal breakdown is a picture of the vertical one. That we have and are sinners. All have sinned. And the Bible then also tells us that God's judgment for sinners is death. In the day you eat thereof, you will surely die. Well, somebody says Adam and Eve were not killed. No, but what entered into the human frame was the principle of death. If you look at the Hebrew, I believe it says something like, dying you will die. It's a process. For most of us, it takes about 70 or 80 years. As you get older, and I'm getting into that ballpark, maybe been there for a while, you feel the aches and pains, you're aware of the flaws and the things that need to be fixed. But you're aware also that one day, something's coming which won't be fixed. And we'll step off the field of time into eternity. Dying, you will die. The Bible also says that if that sin is unresolved, not only will you die here in this world, but you will die eternally. You will be separated from God in what the Bible calls hell. However bad the affairs in the Middle East might be, and they seem to be horrific, that's nothing compared to what it means to be in eternal torment. That's nothing compared to what it means to be suffering for a time without end, because you wanted to be in control of your life and push God out of it. You wanted to be the master of your universe, when in fact you were no more than a little pea in a pod. The wages of sin, Romans 6 will tell us, is death. But right alongside it comes the gospel. I hope you can complete that verse. There are many verses every Christian should know off by heart, and Romans 6:23 is one of them. The wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus. I put in the word free, it shouldn't be there. The gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus. You see how you get the background, the background, and then you get the gospel. People won't want the gospel until they realize the desperate condition that you're in. And we live in a day when people chuckle at sin. I've said before from this pulpit, my mother-in-law used to annoy me because when the children hurt themselves, she would say to them, "Oh, what a sin." She was a lovely woman. I have no complaints about her at all. She was better to me at times than my own mother. But that's another story that she used to say to the children, "Oh, what a sin." And for me, it just encapsulates how the world looks on sin. It's just something bad that happens in the world. And therefore, it's not too important. The Bible says sin separates us from God. Sin brings us into judgment. And the devil is quite happy as long as people don't take sin seriously. Dear friend, everyone sins. So therefore, every human being is in a desperate state. When you look at them, they might be well-dressed. They might be comfortably off. They might be progressing through life in prominence and fame. They might have things that you wish you had. But stand back and just understand that what you're looking at, if they've not got Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, is somebody who's condemned. They're on death row. Not only in this world, but forever. Not only in this world. You and I need to escape from this. Satan has cast a spell on humanity, if I can use that word. I don't know if you've read C.S. Lewis' book. The name has escaped me. Where the senior devil is training the junior one. Screwtape letters, I knew it would come. In there, there's a little passage in which the junior devil has come back and he's complaining to the senior devil that people are not sinning badly enough. And this was the reply. "You will say these are very small sins, and doubtless, like all young tempters, you are anxious to be able to report spectacular wickedness. But do remember, the only thing that matters is the extent to which you separate the man from the enemy, which is God. It does not matter how small the sins are, provided that their cumulative effect is to keep the man away from the light. Murder is no better than cards, if cards can do the trick. Indeed, the safest road to hell is the gradual one, the gentle slope, the soft underfoot, without sudden turnings, without milestones, and without signposts." And as I stand here this morning and consider this, that all have sinned, it brings a solemnity, does it not, to our own lives, to the people around us, to recognize there are no good people. There are just some that are not as bad as others. And for that reason, we need the gospel. We need to hear about the fact that everyone sins. And then Paul in Romans has been explaining sin. What does it mean to actually sin? It means to fall short of the glory of God. Everybody's a sinner. And the problem is, we fall short of the glory of God. Now again, this flies in the face of modern people think. The God of modern man is really God, a man's puppet. A lady yesterday at the door was trying to engage me in a conversation about the God of the Old Testament, as she called him. I was graciously able to say, "We need to sit down and talk about that." And she wanted to excise the God of the Old Testament from the Bible, because to her, he was too horrendous, too judgmental. But you can't do that. What you see in the Old Testament is God's holiness, is God's righteousness, and the God of justice. He's not only a God of love. That same God who in love has sent Christ will at the end of the ages appoint Christ to be the judge of all men, all women, all children. And as the judge, he will act righteously. Paul has been exercised with the church in Rome and ready to preach the gospel to you who are in Rome also. Remember chapter 1, verse 15? For the gospel is the power of God unto salvation. 1 Corinthians chapter 1. And what you and I need to do then is just follow Paul for a minute and try to get a picture of what it actually means to be a sinner. If you've got your Bible in front of you, chapter 1 of Romans goes on from verse 18. Listen to these words. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven. That's God's long-suffering anger. Why and where is it revealed? Against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men. Why did he do that? Look at the next line. Who suppress the truth. That's what humanity does. That's what happens in so many religious institutions. They suppress the truth. They won't deal with the God who's revealed in the Old Testament, with the God who took his son to Calvary and had him executed there as a common criminal because of sin. Because what may be known of God is manifest in them, for God has shown it to them. For since the creation of the world, his invisible attributes are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they, listen again, are without excuse. Because although they knew God, they did not glorify him as God. Pick up that word glorify. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. They did not glorify him as God, nor were thankful, but became futile in their thoughts, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Professing to be wise, they became fools and changed the glory of the incorruptible God into an image made like corruptible man and birds and four-footed animals and creeping things. You can read on the rest later on because it explains an awful lot. But grab this picture as Paul has been writing to the Romans. I'm coming to preach the gospel to you, but before you will appreciate the gospel, you need to hear why we need the gospel. All the same. Every single individual human being since Adam and Eve, all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Dear friends, what is the glory of God? It's a fascinating theme. It seems there are two ways of looking at this. And in the past, I would have followed one in particular. I'm going to follow the other today. Let me explain what I'm talking about if I can. Most often this verse is sees the glory of God as being the revelation of the law at Mount Sinai. But in actual fact, there seems to be a good argument for taking this back before Sinai to the Garden of Eden. Because men and women were in fact created to reflect God's glory. The Garden of Eden is a picture of God's glory. God made Adam and Eve in his own image, and in God's image, Adam and Eve were a witness to the wonder, the power, and the majesty, the vision of the God that made them. They were pictures which made us look at God and say, wow, because God's the artist. You look at the painting, you enjoy the different aspects, the colours, the reality. It always fascinates me. Somebody can paint a face with a paintbrush in such detail. But you look at the painting and then you don't stop there. You look at the corner. Who wrote it? Who painted it? Sorry. And then you think, that was a wonderful painter. What's happening there, you see, is the painter is getting the glory that comes from the painting. God made us. We are his workmanship, Ephesians 2:10. We are his works of art. And what should really happen is that when people look at us, they should say, isn't God incredible? Hasn't he done a marvelous thing? But what happened in the garden was these two took what God had made and broke it. If that was a painting, it would be called an act of the worst kind of vandalism. And that's the condition of mankind. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. We are no longer up to scratch. That's the picture of that fall short. And the Greek tense would indicate that it's not just something we did once. It's something that's real in our life all the time. We're always coming short of what God has made us to be. We excuse ourselves, don't we? Well, nobody's perfect. My Bible says God is. And it says, I think it's Matthew 5 or 6, that if we want to be in a relationship with God, we need to be perfect. Hebrews 10 is my hope, because there it says, I've been made perfect in Christ. But that's for another day. The fact is, I was designed so that when somebody looks at me, they would go, wow, God, you did a good one. And instead, we look at people, and while we find some good bits in them, there's always, what kind of artist painted that? We fall short of the glory of God. And that's been Paul's argument. Chapter 1, as we read. Chapter 2, he's speaking to religious people. In his days, the Jews, but religious people today, who imagine that by keeping some commandments and following out certain orders and rituals and living a clean living life, that they are better than other people. And what Paul starts off this chapter with, isn't it? Chapter 2, what advantage then has the Jew? And he says they've got great advantages. They've got the truth. But then he goes on to explain to us that his purpose is to show that Jew or religious person and the non-religious person are actually in the same boat, and it's sinking. And unless they get a life jacket on, unless there's a rescuer, they will perish. That's where the gospel comes in. For there is not a just man on earth, says Solomon, who does good and does not sin. Truly, this only I have found, Ecclesiastes 7:29, that God made man upright. Isn't that fabulous? Everything was good. But the verse goes on to say, but they, that's the men and women, have sought out many schemes. They have the full responsibility for what they have chosen and where they're going. My people have committed two evils, Jeremiah 2:13. They have forsaken me, the fountain of living waters, and have hewn themselves cisterns, broken cisterns which hold no water. What a mess humanity's in. I've been promising to finish at 30 minutes, and I want to push on just to that purpose. Sin exists, and it's spoiling humanity. The world is broken. All its inhabitants are fatally flawed. It's in Christ that is reversed. He paid the penalty. God laid on him the iniquity or sin of us all. He bore the punishment that men and women like you and I might go free and might rejoice in him. I've run ahead of myself just a wee bit. I want to get to my third point, which is not actually in the verse, and that is the gospel itself, because the verse I've given you is sandwiched between the verses that explain the gospel. Verse 21, but now the righteousness of God, apart from the law, is revealed, being witnessed by the law and the prophets, even the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ, to all and on all who believe, for there is no difference. To all and on all. Give me your ears just for a very few moments of time. It was promised from the foundation of the world. It was witnessed by the law and the prophets. Adam and Eve, even as they receive their judgment, are told one is coming who will crush Satan's head. And you can trace that theme right through the Old Testament. The Old Testament not only tells us about man's desperate condition, it tells us of the promise of God's amazing provision. Jesus Christ, he came to this world to accomplish the redemption of his people. What man couldn't do for himself, God stepped in to do for us. And he, as the testimony would show us, was indeed the only perfect human being since Adam before he fell. And he bore our penalty. And so the gospel is an exhortation to trust him to become your substitute and representative. God has punished him, and those who believe in Jesus are now exempt from punishment. There is now, therefore, no condemnation. Chapter 8, verse 1. Again, a verse you should be able to finish. for those who are in Christ Jesus. Yes, sin still trips me up. Sometimes I might even willingly follow its alluring charms. I may be perfect in Christ, but I'm not perfect as a man yet. But I have a Saviour, and I have a promise that the efficacy and power of his blood delivers me from sin and judgment, and that faith in Jesus Christ is God's key to enjoying those benefits. And it's to all and on all who believe. As I was studying on Friday, it struck me just the difference between faith and belief. You know, they're actually the same, they're from the same word root in Greek. If you were reading Greek, you would see pistos and pistou. Those are the two Greek words. And so I said, what's the difference between faith in Jesus and believing? You see, faith is the noun. Believe is the verb. You remember back in school? We've got a schoolmistress here. What's the difference between the noun and the verb? It might have changed a good deal since I was at school, but a verb is a doing word, isn't it? So you see, it's through faith in Jesus Christ, but it's actually only for those who will do it. The believing word. That's the gospel. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you shall be saved. Isn't that the fabulous gospel? That's what we're here to preach. The seats are not filled yet, but by God's grace, surely. As I preached the first Sunday here, God not only hears our prayers, he sees what we imagine. He's super abundantly able to do exceedingly above all that we ask or I'm imagining the fool. I'm imagining that there's going to be a day when this whole area will be thankful that God plumped us here in Middleton Village. And I'm looking for it in my lifetime. Are you? If you're a Christian, thank God for the privilege that's yours in Christ. I know I've gone over 30 minutes. Thank God that he didn't leave you to sink. And for those who are not yet Christians, and I emphasize not yet, it's time you climbed into the rescue boat. His hand is reaching down. I've only ever heard Robert Stagg preach once. He didn't really like to be up in the pulpit. But the illustration he used stuck with me. And it was that very thing, you see. That you're in the sea, upheld by a life belt, and a rescue helicopter comes, and the rescue pilot reaches down. Will you put your hand up to be lifted out? Thank God, because you have, if you're a Christian. And if you're not, it's time you did. Oh, that we would realize the reason the world's in such a mess is everybody's broken. And the gospel is God's way of fixing it one person at a time. And that's what we need. That's the solution to the Middle East, to Africa, to North Korea. And it should be our passion as Christians that it would be more of a reality in our lives and the lives of those around us. Amen.